I'm going to start off with telling you a little bit about Apollo, because we've got to kind of get some grounding to sort of set the scene here. This is Apollo, a Roman Apollo with his lyre, and you can see the snake of divination creeping up this tree nearby. I like to go to modern things on the internet as well. Here's a really cool Apollo, complete with lyre and bow. Remember, always Apollo with the lyre and the bow. And these are the key symbols of this very important Greek god. Let's just go on and just quickly trot through his attributes. There's so many. I mean, it's quite fantastic. Apollo kind of dealt with everything: music, medicine, divination, very, very important. Archery, and therefore a certain kind of warfare, mathematics and astronomy. And much, much later in the story, Apollo gets associated with the sun. Of course, Apollo is the person who, you know, is the sun crossing the sky in the Roman tradition. But this is late. And I just want to emphasize that. That's the Apollo we all kind of know about now. But this is a late idea. And very importantly in this story, Apollo is a latecomer to the Greek pantheon of gods. Apollo isn't there at the beginning. Apollo actually gets drafted in from somewhere else. And that's what's so intriguing about him. Here he is on a Greek vase, sitting with his lyre in one hand. You can see his bow and arrows here. He's sitting on the tripod at Delphi, which was a site, of course, associated deeply with Apollo. And, you know, the smelly smoke is coming up here, and he's doing his divination. And later, of course, this is taken over by a priestess. But this is the pure Apollo, the lyre, the bow, and the divination. These three things are the key features of Apollo. But he did have a mum. Even the gods have to have mothers. This is Leto. She was a really, as they would say in Greece, cool chick. Because Leto didn't come from Greece. She came from somewhere else. Well, we're not really quite sure where she came from, but let's just sort of catch up. She was a much admired mother in the Greek pantheon. When Apollo was introduced to the gods on Olympus, she was so proud that her son was going to come there. She was the only person who didn't rise in absolute awe at this golden figure who came. All the other gods immediately got up on their feet and said, "Gosh, who's this?" She already knew. She produced this incredible guy. She had also an earlier child. Well, they're always seen as twins, Artemis, the huntress, the chaste huntress. So Apollo and Artemis, both archers, are her children. But the interesting thing about Leto, and you can go into all the kind of derivations of her name and all this kind of thing, is that she is possibly from Hyperborea. Nobody knows where Hyperborea is, and I'll come to that in a moment or two. North of Thrace, somewhere north of the Black Sea, certainly not Greece, certainly in the north. This is the northern part of the world where the northern wind, the boreal wind, blows. But also, she for a while is a she-wolf. She takes the form of a wolf. And this is marvelous. This wolf is definitely wandering around in Hyperborea. And then she, on her wanderings, returns back to the Greek islands. And Zeus couples with her, and she becomes pregnant. This is after Artemis's pregnancy, but they kind of conflated and mixed up. And Hera, Zeus's furious wife, because he's done it again. Well, you know what a philanderer he was. She's furious, and as usual, says, "You can't have your child on any hard ground. It's completely impossible. You cannot give birth." She thought, "Well, I can't give birth in the sea." And then all of a sudden, this island in the Aegean floated up like a bubbling boy. And of course, this is with Delos. And it didn't actually have. And it was floating. So she thought, "Well, that's all right. And then my baby there." So that's where she had her child. And of course, later on, the gods put a chain down to the bottom of the Aegean to make sure that Delos didn't wander around. Anybody had a holiday there? Didn't wander around while you were there, I'm quite sure. But And when he was born, he immediately, you know, like these gods do, these important chaps, they all start saying something important straight away. Dear to me shall be the lyre and the bow, and in my oracles. In other words, there are the three things: the bow, the lyre, and also the divination. So this is Apollo. And the first thing he did, you can see him there, being held by his mother, and he's already got his fabulous composite type Greek bow. I'm an archer and a bowman myself, so I'm very interested in the technicalities of these archery issues. And there's Artemis standing in front, looking actually rather pregnant, I thought, but she's not actually pregnant in the story. And there's a few palm trees, and then there's this hideous monster called the Python, which Hera has sent to basically try and destroy Leto before the birth. But in fact, Python turns up a bit too late, and as soon as Apollo sees Python, he pulls his bow and kills this monstrous, nasty snake, which gives off a fantastic smell. Puthios is the word in Greek, and that's the derivation of the word Python. One of the words for Apollo was Pythios, and his great later, student, Pythagoras, is taking the same route, all out of sort of divination, and the Pythoness is the priestess of Delphi. You all know this, because these all link straight away back to this creature. And then the bow and arrow, note these superb arrows that always hit their mark, was used to kill a nasty giant who was sent by Hera to try and do the family in. But once again, Apollo did the job. This nasty giant was called Tityus. I'm not going to show his picture. So here he is, quite a character. Good with the bow, fantastic with the lyre, inventing music, producing sounds, and kind of magic, and then the prophecy associated with truth, and divination. Now, what about Hyperborea? Well, Diodorus Siculus, that Roman writer, said some really interesting things about Hyperborea. And most of the authorities today think that he was fingering the British Isles when he wrote about it. You can see what he said here. He also said the island is both fertile and productive. And remember, in those eras it was, and had a very temperate climate, which it did relative to what it has done in the last fortnight anyway. And he also brought straight in this idea of Apollo associated with Hyperborea. And Apollo comes into this island every 19 years, which should make Nicholas Mann's eyebrows rise, because straight away, this is one of the key cycles, the major standstills of the moon, perhaps, but one of the 19-year lunar cycles. And here this god is associated with a lunar cycle. He was also born on the seventh day of the month, the most powerful time of the waxing moon. So he's associated with lunar energy, even though he's later solarized by the Romans. And he then brings his harp, his lyre, and he does these incredible dances every night and beautiful hymns to Apollo, which you've heard about. And he sings every night from the vernal equinox on these islands here in Hyperborea, if you like, in Britain, according to Diodorus Siculus, and until the rising of the Pleiades, which is late July. It's about the 14th or 15th of July. So for all those months, every 19 years, there's this astronomical link with this Apollo character, whoever he is. And here, in this part of the world, Apollo has a stately grove with a renowned temple of a round form, beautified with many rich gifts. Well, that's the visitor center now. You all know Stonehenge. And, you know, maybe it will be beautified for 2012, finally. I don't know. But a lot of people have fingered this round temple as possibly Stonehenge. And then also, there's a rich city consecrated to Apollo, whose citizens, Diodorus Siculus says, are all harpists, they're all musicians. And this links up with ancient ideas later expressed about the Scots, the Welsh, and the Irish, particularly being interested in harps and a lyre-type harp, the cruth, as it's called, and so on. So there's a direct link, again, with the idea of this city. It's dedicated to Apollo. It's an Apollo energy. It's here in Britain. And maybe it comes via this wolf woman down into Greece. So we've got these important links. But where is the city? Where is the city of Apollo? Well, this man knew. This is John Wood. He is the premier instigating 18th century architect of 18th century Bath. And John Wood knew that Bath was the city in ancient times, which was the city of Apollo. This is Bath as John Wood helped to design it. Here's a plan of it in 1735 with Queen Square, the first part of his wonderful visionary ideas. This, incidentally, is north-south. And this is the old Roman city here. And then beginning of this modern part, and we've got the rest of all the kind of development up onto the hill here. But this is John Wood's own plan. He had this vision for a new Bath that would reflect the ancient Bath of the past as he saw it, this Apollo city. Here's Queen Square, just some pictures of its beautiful and excellent architecture. But he was no slouch. He went out, just as Nicholas Mann does, out to these sacred sites, and he went to Stonehenge. He was intrigued by the great architecture of these islands in the past, at the time of this kind of Apollo vision. Went to Stonehenge, and he surveyed Stonehenge in 1740, or he published his survey in 1740, and it was the finest survey of Stonehenge until the 20th century. Everybody agrees on that. John Wood's survey is it. Absolutely an excellent surveyor. He was an astronomer, and he was interested in the turn of the heavens and so on and so forth. He then put that exact proportion into his plan of the circus in the Bath. You probably already know this. So he already was transferring a bit of the ancient wisdom and putting it straight into the Bath landscape. And I find that really very exciting. He also thought these guys were probably druids, and of course they had oak groves of acorns, so he put acorns all around the top of the houses on the circus, as you probably seen. He also then went off to Stanton Drew, a big set of stone circles just outside Bath, and he surveyed those rather fancifully but very accurately, and he identified in the proportions all the various ellipses and cycles and orbits of the planets and the different sizes of the planets. And he thought Stanton Drew was the place where the ancients had taught astronomical wisdom, a kind of university, only 8 miles from Bath for the Druids. And then he thought, I'm going to write all this down. So he wrote his first of three editions of a thing called A Description of Bath, which he put all this extraordinarily weird history down, as well as all the other modern things that were happening. And this is a marvelous book to read. And a lot of it is interesting things about all the things you know about in Bath, but then he also wrote about all this weird ancient history, and I'm quite sure that everybody who buys the book flicks through all that because they can find it completely mystifying, can't make a word of it out. I have read it all. It is absolutely fascinating because it links in with our theme. We all know that the founder of Bath, sometime in 900 BC, traditionally, or even earlier or later, was this incredible guy, King Bladud, the wolf lord, Bladud. Bladud means wolf. His dad was called Hudibras, and his son was King Lear. So that puts you into kind of context. He's one of those mythical kings. But he got, as you know, leprosy after coming back from a long stay in Athens, where he learned a lot of new tricks and new ideas and brought them back to England. And then he was sent away from the court in London, and he was wandering around keeping some pigs and in the Bath area, and the pigs had nasty skin diseases, and he saw that they all got better when they rolled in the mud where the hot springs were, and hence he thought, this is where I'm going to have my city, founded Bath. He's the founder of Bath. But for John Wood, there was more to this chap than just Blair Dodd. He, John Wood, was also aware of this chap. This is Abaris. And Abaris is part of Greek myth. A Baris is, in Greek myth, a Hyperborean priest of Apollo's temple in Hyperborea, who travels on an arrow, Apollo's arrow. This arrow was like a witch's broomstick. I don't know how big it was. You could put your leg over it and fly. And Abaris flew from Bath, or wherever he was, flew through the air and went all over Europe. And of course, it was one of Apollo's original arrows that had been left from this fantastic archer god you've seen. So it was a very treasured thing in the British Isles. But Abaris, this is what John Wood read and wrote and expressed in his book. Abaris flew on this arrow and he could do all sorts of things. He landed in one city somewhere in Europe, and there was a plague there, took the arrow, psst, psst, just like Doctor Who with his screwdriver, and the plague was gone. Another place was a bit of a trouble, psst, psst, with the arrow, sorted everything out. Finally, landed in Athens, and they said, you better meet the man. Who's the man? Some chap called Pythagoras. So he was taken to meet Pythagoras. And Pythagoras was already kind of working on, you know, all his ideas of his maths and all the rest of it. And immediately Abaris saw Pythagoras, he saw a kind of reincarnation of Apollo. He thought, wow, this bloke is it. I am going to present him with the arrow. I'm going to give him the arrow of our knowledge from our islands. And Pythagoras said, I don't really need it. He said, yes, you do. You need this, and you will share this with the rest of the world. That was the story that John Wood wrote down. He was so excited about what he could find out about Abaris, what a cool guy he was, and how well dressed he was, and how he was from Hyperborea, spoke Greek, but looked like a Scythian. So he pulled in all the things that we know about Abaris, but he basically got him fixed very nicely on his arrow. This is a picture of a Greek dart, just like one of these arrows that I've been telling you about. This is what it would have looked like in historical times. This is a Greek dart. And this is some of the things that John Wood wrote about Apollo's arrow. He first of all said that the arrow was used by the Cyclops long before the gods arrived to regulate the course of the Earth about the Sun, which is, of course, fantastically geocentric, and also the moon about the Earth. In other words, this arrow was associated with regulating the time and regulating the course of the heavenly bodies. And that it was also a system of knowledge. This arrow characterized knowledge, profound knowledge, which the god Belinus, who is the sun god of the Britons, held. And also, John Wood, being fancifully minded and definitely looking for future tourists and all this kind of thing, he identified somewhere in Bath where Belenus' tree was planted. In fact, it's underneath the new shopping centre near the railway station now. But I know exactly where it is because I've done lots of research. It's actually, if you want to know, it's in the Apple shop where you go and buy computers. It's just underneath the second counter on the left is where the actual Belenus' tree is. Now, that tree was planted, said John Wood, in honour of the arrow. Or, and he keeps using this term, system of knowledge, which was the motions of the heavenly bodies, which was, he felt, and these are his words, secreted with the Hyperboreans. Now, we've been hearing from Nicholas earlier on about the real secrets of the Hyperboreans in terms of their extraordinary astronomical knowledge, and how this knowledge was acquired by Abaris as a priest here in Britain as part of his studies. And then he took the arrow and flew off and did it. But the point about this arrow is it's a system of knowledge. This is Pythagoras. I just got to pop him in because he also is there. Here he is banging gongs. You can see him banging the gongs with a hammer, and it's traditional that he, you know, bang these gongs, these different bits of metal, and he realized they had different vibrations, and he began the whole musical exposition, which led through all the geometry and all the various relationships of harmony and the lengths of strings and quartering and halving and all the harmonic elements which make the octave, and finally bring in that wonderful thing called the Pythagorean comma, and all that stuff, which is just magical to read about and terribly fundamental and extraordinary in terms of knowledge. But all that knowledge, John Wood felt, Abaris took to Pythagoras on the arrow, as part of the arrow. So this is Pythagoras. I'm just putting this up to give you all the willies. This is the only thing that unites us in this room about Pythagoras. Every single one of you who did any mathematics and early geometry had to do this. And so that links us all together. We're unified in Pythagoras, this strange man, mythical, nobody really knows anything about him, named after the smell of a dying snake. Wow, what a thought. But we're all united because you all have to struggle on squared paper, I put it on squared paper, in your notebooks to try and understand a bit of geometry. There it is. I hope you've seen what the arithmetic says. It is really mind-blowing that the square of the length of the longest part of this 3-4-5 triangle is equal to the sum of the squares of the two shorter edges. It's a wonderful piece of stuff, and we'll come across more of it now for something completely different. This is Anne Macaulay standing next to a standing stone in Aberdeenshire. Anne Macaulay died in 1998, and some of you may have come across her or know about her. She was a remarkable lady, a natural mathematician, who didn't really sort of make much at Edinburgh University. She didn't pass her exams after the first year. She came from a very, very studious family of Scots, and she was a natural in the landscape in terms of proportion and the whole idea of geometry. She had a posthumous book written about her, published by Floris Books, which if you're interested in anything to do with these ancient mysteries, I urge you to have a look at. But before that, she wrote an extraordinary chapter in this book called Homage to Pythagoras. You can see her name there, four down. Next to some really big, powerful names, Keith Critchlow, Robert Lawler, Kathleen Rain, people who are really in. This is an incredibly important book to read. You can still get hold of it from Amazon for a sort of £5. In this book, there's a chapter by Anne Macaulay. And what Anne Macaulay was a musician. The mathematical part of her mind had led her to become a student of the guitar, the modern Spanish guitar. She was interested in the way that it was tuned. She was interested in the way it was strung. She was interested in its history. She traced it back and back and back until she found it was merging with a Greek instrument called the cithara. The cithara was, in fact, the word which leads to the guitar. It's exactly the same word. And then she saw that in Greek tradition, because there was a lot written about the cithara, people have made them. You can go on online and you can press a button on your screen and hear what a cithara sounds like as somebody sings an old Greek poem to them, and so on. She found that, in fact, it was derived from Apollo's lyre. So you go from Apollo's lyre, the god of music, through the priests, like Abaris, and all those harpers in the temples, and then you come through the cithara, and finally you arrive at the guitar. And she did a lot of research on this, and in doing this, she identified the Pythagorean mathematics in this instrument, the modern guitar, the cithara, and the lyre. I'm not going to share any of this with you, it's far too complicated. Read about it. Just simply that she identified the pure maths, the pure mathematics of Pythagorean ideas back through. And she saw this as actually also being present in these islands in a way that fascinated her. She was also now doing research into stone circles and finding the same Pythagorean language of mathematics in the stone circles. And she started to identify this as something she called Apollo wisdom. Apollo wisdom was this body of information which was the mysteries of these islands in mathematical terms. And she got very, very excited about this. And she wrote in this first book, while she was still alive, this was published, this incredible chapter, which I'm going to very briefly share with you. I'm not going to take you through the detail, but just sort of the ideas. She realized that the word Apollo, or in its Greek form, Apollon, with an N on the end, was not naturally a Greek word. This is pretty well agreed. It comes from outside Greece. Where does it come from? And what does it mean? There aren't any other words that are really like it. And so she actually decided to examine it in mathematical terms. She thought, there's the name, Apollon. If I take the two L's, or Greek letters lambda, the L's, like this, out of the name, and make two rectangles, I'm sort of putting his name into geometric form. Okay, I've taken out two L's and I've made two rectangles. Now I've got two O's in his name, the Omicrons. I'm now going to make two circles that exactly go around the two rectangles. And I've integrated two more letters. I'm now going to take the letter A, Alpha, the beginning of Apollo's name, and I'm going to draw a big circle that encompasses everything, because alpha is about totality and oneness, so I have to have everything in. And then I've got to take the P, Apollon, or pi, I've got to take that out, and I'm going to fix that by knowing that it's the 17th letter of the alphabet, and I'm going to make the circumference of the circle 17 units so that it fits into the system. So there you can see the circle that she's put onto the system, which is now growing into a figure. Remember, this is a geometrical kind of, how do we put it, vision on the basis of the Greek word Apollon. And then she's got one letter left, nu, in Greek, and she identifies that in a final circle and produces this extraordinary figure. And all the proportions in this figure are the Pythagorean proportions of perfect form. Now, she's not derived this from anywhere. She's intuited it from just the name of the god, Apollon. But she's saying this is the center of Apollo wisdom, the center of Apollo wisdom in these islands. She draws this triangle here and leaves it there. She also shows how these proportions here are the entire musical sequence that you use to tune the guitar and the sitara. The whole thing of music, form, and proportion, and wisdom are all in one diagram. And she left it there, and I thought, wow, look what I can see. Look what I can see. I can see a bow and arrow. Also, I can see in the final part that you do in this construction, which is this P to C length, that length in 4.5 units is absolutely essential. Take that arrow, I'm calling it an arrow, she didn't call it an arrow, she knew nothing about this, I'm suggesting this. But in that arrow, this Apollo's arrow, you have all form in geometric terms. Take the arrow out and it doesn't work. You could just have the arrow but know exactly the length of the arrow, like walking around with a megalithic yardstick, and present it to Pythagoras and say, everything is in this length. And somehow or other, there it is again. And I just want to show you a Greek one, just to show how incredibly synchronistic this is. She didn't copy this, Anne Macaulay, she intuited it. But what's wrong with intuition? So, in constructing the name of Apollon, she seems to have tapped into a rich vein, as I put it, of symbolic synchronicity, or into a form of deep truth about the Apollo wisdom. So that's the Apollo wisdom. But more. This chap dominated her life. This is Alexander Thom. You've come across Alexander Thom before. He was the professor of engineering at Oxford who did 300 and more surveys of stone circles and found, he believed, a kind of megalithic unit called a megalithic yard and all kinds of other things as well. A wonderful book's been written about him by Robin Heath, who's spoken here to you at these conferences in the past. Do read this book. It's like a detective story. It's a fantastic book, Cracking the Stone Age Code. Secrets of the Circle Builders. Every one of these books I'm going to show you is all Secrets of the Circle Builders as we go on. Now, You don't have to remember this in any detail, but they're not just round circles. Alexander Thom found there were ellipses, perfect ellipses. There were flattened circles of a particular kind of form. There were flattened circles of two types. There were egg shapes, types one and two, and there were complex combined circles. And they incorporated Pythagorean geometry. This is what Alexander Thom found 30 years ago. And he published this, and people kind of took him on, and then he became very much persona non grata in the academic archaeological tradition. And today, he is actually on Wikipedia under pseudoscience, along with various other people like John Michel and so on. An insult, absolute insult. But somebody's popped him in there to make sure that he doesn't have any kind of place. And note the timing here, 3200 to 1800, the same dates that Nicholas shared earlier on. I'm going to just dash through some of these. This is just a quick education for you. Don't worry about it. Buy the DVD later if you want the details. These are the ellipses he identified. And if you don't know how to make an ellipse, it's just two pegs, one in your hand, a third sort of stick thing. You walk around two posts, make a circle, make prodding things, and you've made a perfect ellipse. So don't think that these guys who Nicholas was telling us about earlier on hadn't got the techniques to do this. Here is one of those perfect ellipses. And here is a type A and a type B flattened circle. These strange, not perfect circles. Circles to about halfway or two-thirds and then sort of flattened off for some reason. But definitely like that in the environment. And here's how to draw them with just nothing more than a rope and pegs. Nothing else. I have constructed one of these type B circles at a workshop run by Robin Heath, and it's most exciting. He can get primary school kids to make these things. Don't think they're complicated. All you need is a piece of string and three pegs. This is how you do the type Bs. And what are these type Bs about? Well, you might recognize already they look a bit like the old-style National Health specs. You know what I mean? Did you have a type B one? I actually got them, I'm not wearing them today, but there are type B lenses and type A flattened circle lenses. Have you noticed the wisdom, how it comes out in Specsavers? Yeah? There we are. Now, the circle, the perfect circle, is 360 degrees, and you can make that representing 365 days for the solar year. Now imagine cutting a bit of that circumference off to make it flattened and counting up the number of days you've got. Well, when you do that with a type A, you actually have 354.6 days, which is the exact lunar year. And if you do it with a type B, it's 346 days, which is the eclipse year. Don't worry too much about the technicalities, but just let me tell you that these three, circle, flattened A and flattened B, represent perfectly and accurate, to 99% accuracy, these cycles of the moon and the solar cycle. So when you put down one of these stone circles, you are making a very powerful statement about your knowledge of these cycles. There are also egg-shaped ones as well, type 1 eggs and type 2 eggs. These are all at the classification of Alexander Thom. And very recently on Lundy, Robin Heath, aided and abetted by the man who is at the moment actually filming me, Hugh Newman, in 2007, identified in a few scruffy stones on Lundy another one of these egg shapes, which Robin went back with the information which Hugh helped to collect on that occasion, and he did his bits and pieces, and there it was, a perfect type 1 egg shape, newly found, fitting the bill exactly as Alexander Thom suggested, with two perfect 3-4-5 triangles, Pythagorean, in the middle. Can you see them sitting there? So the wisdom is there, and Hugh has helped to give birth to this wisdom. Thanks, man behind the camera. And Robin has gone on and done this wonderful book, Blue Stone Magic, about the stone circles of Wales, just come out in the last 6 months. This is, read about it. It's the best book ever written on stone circles to go and look at in the field, because it tells you about all this inner mystery, which the ordinary straight books don't do. So it's a wonderful book to get hold of. And Robin is particularly associated with that fantastic further Pythagorean triangle of the 12-13-5 variety, and the finding that you can use this pulled out as a string with 30 odd notches on it to predict eclipses, and of course he's identified the incredible lunation triangle between the Preseli blue stones, the island of Lundy. That's why these chaps were creeping around on Lundy that afternoon looking for things, and Stonehenge. I don't know whether the ancients were aware of this or not, but Robin Heath pushed very, very hard to say they must have known. And the implication of this national triangle is quite extraordinary. Is this part of the Apollo arrow wisdom? Back to Anne McCauley. So in this posthumous book that was written by the edited by these two people from her posthumous papers, she returned to many of the sites that Alexander Thom had done. She resurveyed them, she improved on their accuracy, she found that many of them carried this Pythagorean knowledge. Like here, she's identified a 5, 12, 13 triangle. And she also found that the flattened circles often, well, actually, she said always, were based on the pure pentagon. And that the pentagon, the five-sided star, carries within it information which is absolutely impossible to manipulate unless you're aware of the golden mean, 1.618, that incredible figure, and also perhaps even the Fibonacci sequence. The Fibonacci sequence of numbers. Now she's adding to the Apollo wisdom that Alexander Thom identified, she's adding and taking that even further. And her most radical suggestion in her book is that somehow this information, which starts off in the tuning of the lyre of the god, comes down to us as the modern guitar, in a straight line, but somehow this information about Pythagoras from these islands, in this wisdom, somehow or other went to Greece and then went out to the rest of the world. It came from here. Nobody takes her book at all seriously, of course, because she said that. But she was saying exactly what John Wood was somehow tapping into in the 18th century. Now, you've had a lot of funny figures and a lot of maths, without any maths, because I'm not very good at it. And you had a lot of kind of things to swallow, flattened circles and all the rest of it. So we're going to go out in the field now. I'm going to share with you a little bit of field work. There's a beautiful hill in central North Northumberland called Beacon Hill. This is a cup and rick marked stone just nearby it. It's a precious place that I've been going to since I was about 5. So that's over 60 years. Just nearby on that hill, there's a scatter of stones. You can see Celia, the scale, standing there with our dogs. The stone behind her is absolutely crucial in this scatter of stones. These rocks that have sat amongst the heather there are taken no notice of by archaeologists. Their notice has been drawn to these, but they take no notice. Paper has been written and presented to the journal Antiquity about these stones, and it was rejected. I'm going to just take you through to the Apollo wisdom that's sitting in these stones. This stone that Celia was next to, let's just have a look at it again, you see how big it is. See that stone just behind her head? This is the stone. It's got a hole right through it, a hole nearly 8 foot long through the sandstone, exact straight line hole. The hole was discovered by this man who I am going to dedicate this whole lecture to. This is David Thompson, who tragically died too early in 2002 on a journey which was going to lead him for he and I to get together to write up and make a paper out of this particular wonderful site. David sadly died of a heart attack. Was walking along here, quite kind of ambling around, as good Northumbrians do, with his 11-year-old boy, when his son said, "Dad, Dad, look what I found. Look, you can see right through this stone." Because he was a little boy, and we adults just walked past, no adults had ever seen the hole. But David Thompson's son did. And in 1987, David told me about this because I was running an Earth Mysteries course. David was one of the students on it. And we went to this place time after time. And you can put your head on a chin stone, which is where David's, that's where you put your chin. Just put your chin there. And at eye level, you see exactly through the hole. And when you see how this has been carved, this has been chipped away, the rock. We've got a sighting place, which is quite extraordinary. This is David's photograph. This is midsummer sunset. The line is exactly on midsummer sunset. And this is David's brilliant original photograph from 1987, which has never been showed before. And this is me and Celia in 1992 having a little ceremony there, because we quite often went up to this very important solstitial point when we were in Northumberland to remember the solstice and see Celia with her drum there. And if you don't believe me, as David pointed out, he discovered there was a stone which had a hole put through it, but it hadn't got completely finished. You can just see the hole there. And it goes right the way through the stone, but it's fallen over. And I've pushed a bamboo through both sides of the hole, and they don't meet, but they stick out in exactly a line, which shows that these guides were trying to drill a hole through. Absolutely fascinating, because look at the size of the stones. And then I realized, when I'd gone up with David Thompson in 1987, that there were two large stones, which, if you put them in an alignment, they had two edges. And the two edges were exactly on an east-west alignment. In other words, an equinoctial alignment. And I realized that if you looked out to the sea, like you are doing on this photograph, you can see the way, sorry, it's a bit dark, the edges of these two stones are here. And you can look out to the horizon on the sea, 26 miles away, and that on the equinox, the sun should rise and then shoot through this gap between these two stones. Then I realized that if you saw the gap between the two stones, this was all in 1987, I saw a rock up on the hill, which was exactly on the edge line of these two, the gap. You see the gap here? This stone up here was exactly on the line. And I thought, they would have marked the rock. I had this vision, they would have marked the rock. I remember with my son running up the heather here and said, hey, quick, Simon, come and have a look at this, come and have a look at this. And he said, what, Dad? I said, I haven't found it yet, but I know it's there. And when I got up there, I found this rock here. You can't see it very well, I'm afraid, here. But down the rock, I scrabbled off the heather that was completely covering this rock in 1987, and I identified this long carved line here. Can you just see it there? Now, that long carved line would be exactly where the shadow of this incredible face-like rock, can you see the face? This face-like rock would throw the shadow on the morning of the equinox, exactly on that line. And this was the only time I've made an archaeo-astronomical finding, really. But this was incredible, because it was a prediction. My prediction was they would have marked a rock in some way. I scrabbled the heather, dozens and dozens of years of growth, and found the line, which has been acknowledged by others as being made by humans. So here we are, on the morning, on the 21st of September 2007, Celia and I have been up several times to capture this moment where the sun is going to come through. There it is on the horizon, rising over the sea, 26 miles away. Look at the gap between the two stones. It's exactly in the right position. This is always very exciting to do. And there is the shadow, and there is the line on the rock. Can you just see the line on the rock? And the shadow from the incredible face that's there. And here's Celia pointing to the shadow. And it's been written up by a guy called Crispian Oates, who was a later colleague of David's before David died. And his book has been looked at, and nobody takes it seriously, and it's one of the best possible accounts of an archaeological, archaeo-astronomical interpretation of a site. But I thought, and this is the rock again, you can just see the hole here, the other side of it, and that's Celia, I think, over there. I decided I was going to re-survey this set of rocks. So I did. I did a complete survey of the rocks. And then I took Crispy and Oates' survey, which was quite respectable, and I then found it made a perfect type A flattened circle. And I've discussed this with Robin Heath since, and he thinks, wow, you should publish this, Anthony. But I don't think I could get it into any journal because no archaeologists take any of this seriously. This is the Apollo wisdom on a hillside in Northumberland coming to me, just as when Hugh and Robin found those stones on Lundy, they found the type one egg-shaped circle. But there's more. This lady, Caroline Holmes, who is another gatekeeper person in the north of Northumberland, is by another stone, and she's showing us another hole. Here it is. More work to do, just to tantalize you. Now, for something completely different. I've just taken you outdoors to sort of get you into the right way for the rest of this talk. Remember, we're talking about the wisdom. Now, these are Platonic solids. A lot of you will have bought this little set of beautiful little crystals because you think they look nice, or maybe you're aware in some kind of way they're carrying some kind of special quality or energy, and indeed they do. These figures, first written about, as far as we know, by Plato in the 4th century BCE in Greece, but, you know, only 350 years before Christ's birth. These four figures as material figures are the only shapes which can be circled by a sphere so that the points of all the crystal edges touch the inside of the sphere. There are no other forms. That's what the five Platonic solids are. Of course, the square, you know, the tetrahedron made up of, you know, four sharp points, the octahedron, the icosahedron, and the dodecahedron. You heard all these words. They really are incredibly important. Plato realized that they were made, the tetrahedron, octahedron, and icosahedron, of a basic triangle, which was exactly 90 degrees, 30 degrees, 60 degrees, a special kind of triangle, which Plato identified also was present in the octahedron and the icosahedron. And he therefore posited, calling one fire, one air, and one water, that these three elements would be able to merge together because they were made of the same kind of triangle basis. This was a very exciting and important idea that Plato seems to have at least written down for the first time. And then you get the square, which has got, of course, a 45, 45, 90 degree triangle, and that's a different sort of triangle here, this one. And then finally, on the dodecahedron is 12 sides of pentagons. A very, very, very important figure because I'll tell you a little bit more about it in a moment, but it's the nearest of these figures to a complete sphere. So it has a very particular quality, and the Greeks called it ether. They had earth, air, fire, water, the four elements, and then finally there was this almost transcendent element, which was the whole universe, ether. Now that's what you buy when you buy a set of little crystal things. You're buying unbelievable wisdom. Three basic triangles, which are, for the Greeks, the building blocks of the universe. I mean that most seriously, the building blocks of the universe. So people who were manipulating and understanding Platonic solids had a finger, a tab, on the whole basis of the universe. The sort of thing that Nicholas was hinting at with regard to the Avebury wisdom earlier this morning. So this was the Platonic insight, and he wrote all that down in mostly Timaeus. Much later on, Kepler, who's writing about Copernicus's ideas that yes, the sun is in the center of our system and the planets all move around it. So we'd moved away from Copernicus from the idea of the earth being in the center, which is what the Greeks apparently mostly thought, the geocentric view, moved to a heliocentric view, but Kepler was grappling now with what were the shapes of the orbits of the planets. And he saw them as a series of nested platonic solids, each being surrounded by a kind of circle. And these, this is Kepler's original writing translated into English. You can see his diagrams. He's beginning to put these shapes, these platonic solids, into a nest of spheres. And here is a very famous picture of his doing that. And underneath you can see two of the ellipses. You're getting used to ellipses now, of what the actual planetary orbits look like. This was Kepler's great breakthrough. But the point is, he wouldn't have been able to do it or get there without having a mathematical understanding of platonic solids. So, where now? Keith Critchlow wrote this extraordinarily important book 20-odd years ago. It's been reprinted, and Roma usually has it on their table to buy time tan still. The subtitle, again, is New Light on Megalithic Science. All my books this morning are about that kind of thing. And in this book, Keith Critchlow drew attention to the fact that these platonic solids, and these are, this is a photograph of my little set, they're all very tiny, I wish I had big ones, could be found in Scotland. In Scotland, sometime between 3000 and 2000 BCE. All over Scotland, over 400 of these carved stone platonic solids, representing all the platonic solids, all five of them, meaning that whoever carved them had some understanding of this mathematical wisdom, this profound wisdom. I mean, even just the idea that each of these shapes could only be kept inside a circle, a perfect sphere, is in itself quite incredible, quite magical. And he's put tapes on them here so you can see, and they're all carved in granite. They've lasted a long time. None of them were ever found in graves. These were not grave objects. These were objects which were, well, for some reason or other, not part of the journey of the dead. Interesting, that. They're found kicked up in fields, farmers have picked them up, and how many are there? There's over 400. And this lady, called Dorothy Marshall, in 1976, in the Proceedings of the Antiquaries of Scotland, wrote this paper called Carved Stone Balls, in which she just describes them and has absolutely no idea what they are. She never even mentions platonic solids. She has a little addendum 2 or 3 years later, because after producing this paper, 20 people came out of the woodwork and said, I've got one of these. We've had it on our mantelpiece ever since Auntie gave us one. And so she put them in the museum and collected another 25 or 26. And since then, there's been not a single publication ever considering, except for Keith Critchlow. And you know, they derive from natural objects. Here's a beautiful crystal octahedron, which I bought in Glastonbury a long time ago, and I photographed it next to my own octahedron platonic solid. But look how in the natural world. Did you know that Pythagoras' father was a gemologist? He carved gems. Coming into his little workshop with the little boy, Pythagoras to be, Dad, Dad, what are you doing? And this stuff's coming into the workshop. And if you take that octagon, just so that you can put your head around it again, remember, it's got 6 points, 4 around here, and 1 at the top and 1 at the bottom. And if you put a kind of mushroom thing on each of the 8 points, and then begin to kind of cloak it in stone, keeping the idea that it's really a circle as well as an octahedron, you'll begin to create the shape. But imagine having the vision and the understanding and the visual spatial capacity, or the mathematics, or all of those things, to be able to do it. And here are some examples. There's a perfect square on the right, but notice how it's been carved so that it can become a circle. In other words, the understanding that it's a circle and a square is there in this culture in northern Scotland, 2,500 BCE. And there's a mixed one, which you can see is an octahedron, the eight sides, and it's also incorporating the square inside it. So you've got the two nested forms being identified by these primitive barbarians. And here is the gift. This is the gift that these islands gave to the world. This is the gift that was debated at the FIFA meeting 2 days ago. The football. The football was given to the world as a dodecahedron, recognizing that this was the symbol of the cosmos. This was the symbol of totality. And we have culturally called that football. No change, no difference. Mind you, you hurt your foot if you kick this granite one around. This is the oldest dodecahedron known to our history on this planet, and it comes from Scotland, the oldest granite piece. And as Keith Critchlow speculates in his book, and which I'm prepared to speculate here, the man or woman who carved this didn't do it idly, did it knowing that this shape constituted this profound wisdom of so close to a circle. Nothing else could be closer that had sharp edges. It was impossible. And in fact, in Plato, there's a wonderful thing, a wonderful scene where he has Socrates, who's always his mouthpiece. Somebody comes up to Socrates and says, "Well, what does the universe look like, Socrates?" And Socrates says, "It looks like a child's leather ball, stitched together." You know what I mean? Lovely answer. There it is, the football. And my favorite, this is called the Towie Stone, found in a sewer in the 1890s near Aberdeen, beautifully carved. The symbols on the carvings are the same symbols that you get in the passage graves of Newgrange and now from Dowth in Ireland. The same mystical spirals, the same symbolic shapes, but they're on this representation of something which is universal wisdom, all put together in one stone, a circle, a tetrahedron, and the mystery of these actual symbols. Really my favorite one. And just to, I have one at home, an exact facsimile. It's the size of a cricket ball. We won't go on into cricket because that's too exciting in Adelaide at the moment. For me, anyway, I'm up every morning listening to what's going on. But every time I think of a kookaburra ball versus a Duke's ball, I'm thinking, what's the platonic solids in cricket? There's got to be something there. We've got football pinned down. Cricket is the other great wisdom for mankind, in my view. You won't cut that from this film, I'm quite sure. There is the tetrahedron. On top of the tetrahedron, which is the circle, what wisdom there are in these stones. And this is where they were found. All over Scotland, one in Ireland, one got to Norway, and that's it. And I asked Keith Critchlow a few years ago, have any been found anywhere else in Europe? And he said one or two have been found in Bronze Age Europe much, much later on, but nothing like the set that he drew attention to in his wonderful book, Time Stands Still. And recently that book was reviewed by Paul Devereux in that wonderful new journal called Time and Mind, which at Stars and Stones the other day we were hearing about from Paul. And Paul has written in his review, when are you going to look, you archaeologists, at these incredible platonic solids and take them seriously? As he said, when is archaeology going to have balls? Finally, as I run into the end of my talk, I'm just going to take you through some other things. Bronze Age artifacts. So we're moving forward 1,000 years now because we've now got metals in these islands. Remember, the metals of bronze and gold were worked much earlier in the Middle East, but we had them turning up from about 2,200 onwards. We have gold and bronze things turning up here. And they show clearly a preoccupation with cycles of the sun and the moon. And I'm just going to take you through some objects which you've seen before. This one, the Trondheim sun chariot, found in a bog in Denmark. Same culture, Bronze Age, same mathematical ability, beautiful object made of bronze. Clearly it's the sun, an Apolline kind of idea, being pulled through the air by the horses, like Apollo's chariot. On one side, bronze, beautiful gold, but shiny gold leaf on the other side. And when you look at it in detail, you have information sitting here. And this information points to indeed a lunar cycle information. And an analysis has been done, but I've been doing a lot more work on this because I'm researching all this at the moment personally. This is the Nebra disk. People always say, how big is it? Found in North Germany a few years ago. Wonderful story around it. Look it up. Fantastic story. But clearly it's about the sun and the moon. Made of bronze with gold pieces on it. Again, 1600 BCE, like the Trondheim chariot, around about the same time, 1500 BCE. We're just out of the megalithic period, but we've still got this wisdom. And you can see here, some Germans have suggested, you know, how that the constellations could be found on this. But this is also an astronomical instrument which can be used to kind of actually identify interesting horizon event phenomena and so on. But this is the wisdom that's sitting there from North. The Nebra, N-E-B-R-A, N-E-B-R-A, Nebra. And then I want to tell you about the witch's hats. Now, these are some of my most favorite objects. They are wonderful. And I have to tell you, this one is called the Berlin hat. It's a bit gloomy here, but it's so beautiful to look at, in very good condition, found in Germany. But I want to tell you straight away, there were six found in a bog in Ireland in the 17th century. And the Irish guys who picked them out of the bog thought they were containers for carrying water, didn't realize they were hats. Tore them all up, shared them out, and that was the end of the Irish hats. And sadly, we haven't got any in the British Isles, but the point is we obviously did have them in the British Isles, the hats. Let's have a quick look at some of them. That's about a meter high. Can you imagine walking around in a ceremony with this on your head? Incredible things. I love them. Here's another one. Again, they're all a bit gloomy just to look at. This one here, and they've got funny symbols on them. Let's have a look at the symbols in more detail. Ah, sun wheels, moon disks, funny things to count. And indeed, they've been counted, and they are calendars. They are carrying magical information about the sun and the moon and the cycles of the sun and the cycles of the moon. And imagine you've got one of these hats on. You've got your hat on your head. What's the next bit of your clothing like? Let's go to Wales to find out. The mould cape in the British Museum, one of the 100 objects, which is in this wonderful radio series we've just heard of 100 objects. Again, found in the end of the 19th century by some labourers who said, whoa, boys, started to rip it up. You can have that bit, you can have that bit. And it all went torn up and off it went. And then a local priest said, hey, there's something in this, and he bought two bits back, and over the next 50 years, the British Museum bought other bits back, pieced it all together, and made this wonderful thing. Except, it doesn't fit somebody who's very, very big and tough. It fits somebody who is really quite slight, maybe a teenager or a very old man. Very interesting. You want me to stop? And what's all this about? Another change of focus quickly. I'm in my last few moments now. Barry Cunliffe, Sir Barry Cunliffe, sometime professor of archaeology at Oxford, wrote an incredibly important book in 2001, 2002, called Facing the Ocean. This was a book which really took archaeology by the scruff of the neck and in a very personal way said there was a culture of people and they all shared the Atlantic Ocean. From a very long time ago. They looked out to the west. They had incredible skills as mariners. And by implication, navigation skills. They later had common languages, their Celtic languages, the Iberian Celtic, Breton, Cornish, Welsh, Gaelic, and Irish Gaelic. Stephen Oppenheimer, in a book about the origins of Britain, I've shown you this slide before, shows that we genetically, in these islands, derive really from somewhere in the Basque Country, where there was a thing called a post-Ice Age refuge. That means a little cluster of people who'd hung on the edge of the ice, all speaking the same weird language and all carrying the same genes. And these people went up by what was then the beginnings of the Bay of Biscay and all the way around to the Orkneys. Remember, England and Britain haven't split off yet. They don't do that till about 5,000 BC. And basically, all the people up here, the Welsh, and indeed what was to become the English, all share this genetic package. Even in Kent, people who've lived in Kent for generations are carrying 70% of this genetic package. Out in the west of Ireland, we're talking about 88%. But the point is that this is the genetic basis of our culture. Read it. I read about it in this book. It's a paperback. It's a wonderful book. Do read it. And then Stephen Oppenheimer points out that the later migrations of the Saxons and the Norse and the Romans and the rest, they produce nothing into our genes. Tiny. 5% of our genes come from all these other invasions. We really, these people, out of the Basque area. As indeed Barry Cunliffe pointed out in his book, he saw two main focuses for these people, one around the Straits of Gibraltar and one around the sort of Brittany area into Ireland. And incidentally, Barry Cunliffe has gone on and written another paper, very, very interesting, in 2008, in which he proposes that the Celtic languages, whenever they started, began here. Didn't come over from Middle Europe across in waves, which is the conventional idea, but actually began in these places along with seaboard culture. And that the Celtic languages then went eastward, not westward, from the purity that they're here. So this is another eastward drift of information. And these are rock carvings found in Ireland and all other places, all of which look a bit like humans. And if you do a map, as Richard Bradley has done, and other archaeologists, showing the way in which this culture of Ireland, it's across into Sweden as well, this Atlantic seaboard culture is carrying the same symbols, just as it's doing in North Northumberland, in that site I was showing you earlier on, indeed at Avebury and in the passage graves of Ireland and down to all the rich material there is in Portugal and Spain. Quite incredible. And this, of course, is the culture that made the megaliths. Not only did they make the megaliths, this is the culture that you've been hearing about so much this morning, which originated the idea of megaliths. Megaliths start off in Ireland and in Brittany as early as 5,500. Some people even say 6,000. There's some disputes over the dates. Possibly the earliest dates are in Western Ireland, 6,000 BCE, for creating things out of stone on a vast kind of basis. Now, look at the way you creep then eastwards. You then go to Newgrange, you go to Stonehenge, you go to Avebury, but of course, as Nicholas was telling us earlier this morning, there were things at Avebury, big stones, which predated the henge. So how old are those? And finally, amongst other places, you can go to Egypt, which is, according to the dates Robert Temple was sharing with us just the other day, these are Robert Temple's new dates, 2,800 to 2,600, 200 years earlier than the conventional dates for the Giza pyramids. So what is the influence of this Atlantic seaboard megalithic culture on places to the east? I don't know. These are the megaliths. This is Duddo's Stones in Northumberland, one of my favorite pictures in the moonlight. Just a beautiful place, which Celia and I have some very, very special memories of. And this, in Brittany, is a 10-meter high stone. 10 meters high. That's a big stone. It's actually 31 and a half feet. I converted it into feet the other day on my calculator so that I'd know. A very, very big, fat, beautifully finished stone. We haven't got anything as big as this in England, but this is where the megalith culture started from. And here, at a place called Breeze, is the Grand Menhir de Breeze. Here it is. It fell over. It's the largest dolmen, menhir, standing stone in Europe. It's now been shown that it did actually stand up at one stage, because the cynics have said it was too big and they never ever got it to stand up. It weighs 342 tons. The stone that it came from, the quarry, well, the best quarry for the exact match of the stone is over 80 kilometers away. The nearer one, which is possibly not a proper match geology-wise, is 4 kilometers away. The archaeologists have said it would have taken 4,000 men, God knows how long, to pull this or float it around to get it here. I mean, you know, I just leave you with all that. I don't know how they did it, but nor does anybody else. But the point is, we people on these islands and in Brittany were doing this successfully, engineering-wise, beautiful carving-wise. Look at the carving that's been done here, chipping away, perfecting this stone. Oh, I didn't tell you how high it is. 21 meters high, 66 feet high, in a very crucial key geomantic position in terms of moon and sun and all the stuff that you've been hearing from Nicholas was going on at Avebury. And the date, at least 1,000 years before Avebury. At least 1,000 years before. And at least 1,500 years before the pyramids at Giza. Somebody had the technology to do this. Somebody had the knowledge and the insight. It's in Brittany. Yeah. So I return to my dear friend Abaris, who carried Apollo's arrow, a system of knowledge, to Greece. So the story goes. Thank you.